Today is Trent Reznor's birthday, and I wanted to do something different on my channel than the long-form analyses videos that I usually do, so here goes. 9 underrated Nine Inch Nails tracks that I think should get all the love in the world, in no particular order. This song is so grungy. It's got some of the best production. The rock drums are so satisfying. Just listen to the fills alone. And I'm a huge sucker for sludgy tempos anyway, so this song was an immediate yes for me. Oh, that crunchy bass line pedal tone gives way to this sort of fragile-esque chorus. Beautiful piano, just a little bit discordant against a really harmonious melody. I just love the way Nine Inch Nails uses contrast in every way across the board. And in this case, I feel a lot of contrast in the harmony. And the piano is a lot of what's bringing in that dissonance and discordance because of the chromatic movement of the melody. The line between beauty and ugliness begins to blur. This is also a great example of how Trent weaves this instrument, the piano, into a genre that typically would not feature such an instrument. He does it so, so well. I also just love at the end when he's repeating, "I don't know." Absolutely perfect in my eyes, or in my ears. These pulsing, clicky guitars keeping time in the absence of drums. This unsettling but beautiful melody that haunts us and dances around the Mixolydian flat six mode, really emphasizing what makes that mode sound the way it does. Wide open fifth, that crunchy flat six, that edgy flat seven, and then the major third creating that tritone. Tritone is such an important part of the sound of this song, and then the beautiful reharmonization that happens. Always ending on a tritone. The chord progression changes. It gives new meaning by creating new points of tension and release as the atmosphere of the song builds and breaks like a wave. We're left with this pulsating tritone while this like thunder kind of envelops us. You might think that Hell would sound like Pinion or some other song on Broken, but no, it sounds so much more restrained, a much more hopeless place. That feeling of being trapped in something horrible that you used to find beautiful. Oh my God, this is probably one of the best songs I think ever written. And I will be doing a whole video on it. Some people say that it was about David Bowie. It's a very, very sad, mournful, heartbreaking song. But some folks say that it came out around the With Teeth era and that it was supposed to be on that album Bleed Through. Either way, it's about loss and we have all suffered losses, so it's just so relatable. I just love everything about this song. This slow, melancholic waltz. It's so sparse, it feels so far away, so out of reach. It's like this mournful ballad, almost like a dirge, and this sort of unsettling, insect-like, buzzing synth and his vocals. Kind of this microtonal, like just mathematically unsettling frequencies. They slowly swell in and kind of overtake everything. Oh, along with strings too. It's very cinematic. And this beautiful piano melody reminds me a little bit of Right Where It Belongs, Zero Sum, any sort of ascending stepwise Nine Inch Nails piano melody. So. simple and yet so longing. This discordant moaning and wailing, it builds and builds and builds, and then it breaks, and then Trent's vocals come in. It's so sparse, almost like he can barely get the words out.
And if you see my friend.
Anyway, there's a lot more I could say about this song, but let's just say if you need to process some grief, you might want to check out this track.
Yes, everyone seems to be asleep.
This track is still kind of fresh for me, but I've been listening to it a lot lately and getting to know it better. And I really, really like it. It feels like both nostalgic and modern. Even though it has a classic verse, chorus structure, there's something about the drums and the sort of repetitive, like rolling down the hill feeling that I get from this song that makes it feel sort of timeless and organic and unpredictable. And the kind of low whisper vocals, sort of stream of consciousness lyrics has a similar cadence and vibe to me as Zero Sum. I think the transitions also are very fluid, and I don't even think that the phrases are particularly even, so it just feels like the song itself is a stream of consciousness, and we just sort of walk into the song. It's like it's been going forever, and it will continue after we leave it. And if you're not completely paying attention, you might just miss how beautiful and poignant this chorus is. And all the way, culminating in this beautiful falsetto against like a swirling descending pad. In a lot of ways, kind of reminds me of the descending pattern of the downward spiral melodic motif. The bottom of the song just falls out from underneath us. We're floating, detached. While Trent's crooning, "I'm locked inside here, I have to stay with people who aren't here all the way." And it just sort of slowly devolves into this discordant, like, Dolby intro at the movie theater. Anyway, I recommend that you listen to this song a bunch of times until it starts to grow on you. Another underrated album, in my opinion. This track is one of the standouts to me on the slip. I've always loved it, and I don't think it gets talked about enough. This song is another example, I think, of straddling that line between beautiful and ugly. Of course, that's an oversimplification, but what I'm trying to say is that harmonically, there are some things happening that are very discordant and chromatic, and on top of that are melodies that actually sound really consonant and not discordant. And so it's that contrast that brings a lot of interest and a lot of, I don't know, a sense of inner conflict in a way of like, how do I really feel? It's just so complex. Sort of minimal, delicate, synthesized drum groove. Also, there are four distinct melodies in this song, but I'll save that for the full-length video. I think Hesitation Marks as a whole is underrated, so I could have picked pretty much any song from this album, pretty much. But I wanted to highlight In Two, because every time I hear In Two, I'm thinking, damn, this is such a good song. It's so good. How is it so good? This part is so good. And then there's this part. I love the groove with that sort of delayed snare. I just love how Trent leans on the flat 7 and accentuates the flat 2 in the scale. Split, split in two. This is our one. And then we got sort of hinting at a Phrygian or a Phrygian dominant mode, which is often used in like metal and in other parts of the world. It just has a really interesting sound to it. And then we get this like vocoder vocal where he's singing about the violent nature of shedding your skin and leaving that old part of you behind. And then regular Trent joins in. Someone else. And you can hear him harmonizing with himself on this pretty tight interval, a major second. No, it wasn't me, no. Then he descends the scale and he doesn't actually come to a point of rest. He just stops shy of that point of rest. Stopping on the sixth degree, that is not a place of rest harmonically. So this would be our place of rest. Then he harmonizes with himself, which is such a beautiful sonic illustration of having sort of a split. It's getting harder to tell the two of you. Those harmonies are so cool. And there's that beautiful bridge. Just don't know anymore. Just don't. And then his backup singers in the live version. Oh my gosh, that's transcendent. Just don't. Hesitation Works has a production polish to it, I would say, that we really hadn't heard on Nine Inch Nails albums before, and that can sometimes feel almost a little too squeaky and too clean, given what we're kind of used to. But in the case of Intu, I think it creates a sonic palette that makes me salivate. Palette? Smorgasbord. Basically, what I'm trying to say is it's so damn well mixed, it almost makes me angry. I definitely recommend checking it out on headphones and turning it up. Yet another underrated track from With Teeth, in my opinion. In fact, I didn't even know it was considered an underrated track. I just figured everyone could see the genius and the beauty of this track from the get-go. It turns out no one really talks about it much, or it rubs them the wrong way. I find it to be one of the most powerful, immersive, and hypnotic Nine Inch Nails songs there is. It is sort of unusual production-wise. It's like ambient, but also highly rhythmic, and it feels a lot like this heaving kind of breathing quality that goes in and out of phase and can be very disorienting and kind of grating. But if you kind of let yourself be taken by it, it's so, so powerful. Such a gorgeous emphasis on the supertonic as well, which is the note just above the tonic. And what this song builds to always manages to squeeze a bunch of tears out of my face. It's transcendent and almost spiritual for me. Just the chord progression combined with the layering of his vocal harmonies while he's singing, "Ooh, we will never die. Ooh, beside you in time." Oh my gosh. Done a full-length video on this. It was one of my earliest videos, so if you want to know more about what I love about this track, you can go check out that video. Here's a little link. I just listened to Ghost 5 for the first time, and I absolutely loved it. I love ambient music. I love music that sounds like it could be set to film. I love instrumentals. This track has a melody that was just ringing in my ears for days, and I couldn't wait to get back to it. It's just so purely beautiful and exquisite, and it sounds like it's in the Dorian mode. A great real-world example is Mad World by Tears for Fears, and another one is Wicked Game by Chris Isaac. This mode has a sort of longing to it. It sounds like a minor scale, but with this one note that just shoots through like a glimmer of hope. It's a little higher than you expect, and so it's even more crushing when the rest of the harmony returns to that dark minor tonic chord. I just find it to be so angelic and poignant and overwhelming, similarly to how Beside You in Time affects me, also with a stress on the supertonic. I feel like this ascension that happens when I hear this note is emphasized. And that creates usually an interval with the lower end that's called a ninth. I've got a lot of videos where I talk about the ninths in Nine Inch Nails. It's just above the strongest point of gravity in a song. It's not this. I'm often so drawn to sort of the atmosphere, the cinematic qualities of Nine Inch Nails music, and this to me has such an evocative atmosphere. I feel like a movie is playing in my head when I listen to this song. I would say the last 3 minutes of this song especially are so stunning. It feels vast and ancient, like there's an orchestra inside of me sort of orchestrating the rhythms of my own body, the swelling, these beautiful chords. It just feels unbearably human. Oh man, this song, there is nothing else like it. I don't hear people talking about this song, and I can understand why, but I absolutely love it. I mean, like, guitars, horns, marching, chanting. What is this track? It's brilliant is what it is. It's phrased in a strange way, so you can interpret it as like three measures of 4-4, or you can interpret it as like a slow 6-4, just kind of how I hear it. 3-4-5-6, or like 1-2-3-4, 1-2-1-2-3-4, 1-2. It's so weird and amazing. So, okay, into the vocals. Yeah, so we've got these really interesting vocals coming in on that flat 7. And then we have a chromatic run up to the tonic, and that's sort of mimicking the guitar going. This chromatic bass line is so menacing too. And then this melody that's first being played by guitar and later sounds like it's being played by a horn. Mixolydian flat 6 mode, which is one of the most prevalent modes on the Fragile, in my opinion. And he's doing an amazing job of really bringing out the qualities of that mode that make it sound the way it does with this melody. The contrast between the major third, which we associate with the major scale, and the flat 6 and flat 7, which we associate with the minor scale. Then we get these parallel thirds, which remind me a lot of the chorus of Closer. This sort of implication of this triumphant dominant 7 chord closes things out. The yelling gets louder and louder. It's like you're listening to a really old movie through a really old TV. And it's like slowly we come into the present, almost like nothing's really changed from way back then. And then we're just kind of left with this like drum line and the marching of the feet. That's a different video. Anyway, happy birthday, Trent. Thank you so much for giving us the gift of your music. If you like this video and you'd like to see more like this, please let me know, because I, believe you me, I have so many more Nine Inch Nails tracks that I think are underrated. And be sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of my other videos.